Hello friends. In my previous video, I introduced the concept of odometry, gave a brief introduction to how it works, and noticed some of the strengths and weaknesses of such a system. In this video, we'll be going much more in depth. We'll talk about how we actually use odometry data to calculate the position and orientation of the robot. We'll fully go over all the math and calculations, and hopefully by the end of the video, you have a good grasp of how all the math behind odometry all clicks together, and how you can go about writing actual code for it. The explanations may sound a little complicated at first, but I promise that if you stick around to the end of the video, things will really start to clear up. And if you have any questions at all, please leave a comment down below and I'll do my best to answer them.
Now, this is the second of an entire series on the implementation of position tracking. By the end of the series, you should fully understand the mechanics behind odometry and be able to code out motion algorithms to go along with it. I'm a big fan of odometry and control theory, and I really hope these resources can help get you into it too. All right, once again, we have a lot to cover, so let's dive straight into it. The core of the odometry tracking algorithm is to use our tracking wheels to provide the robot with live data on two vectors, the position vector D and orientation vector theta. The position vector tells the robot where exactly it is on the field, and the orientation refers to where the robot is facing relative to the field. To find these two vectors, we want to model the robot's motion as an arc, like this. But what does this mean, and how does the math work out? Let's start with a box over here. This box is our bot. It has three tracking wheels and a tracking center. All our measurements will be done relative to this tracking center. In other words, instead of tracking the whole bot moving along the field, we'll be focusing on just tracking this point. Normally, you should think of your tracking center as just the center of your bot. It is actually the placement of the tracking wheels, these wheels, that affects the math and are the ones you need to pay the most attention to. If you don't know what tracking wheels are or why we need them, please first check out the first video of the series on the introduction to odometry, linked in the description below. It'll help you better understand what's going on in this video. There are three main rules that you need to take note of when placing these tracking wheels. The first of which is that all these tracking wheels, left, right, and back, must be perpendicular to the tracking center. Secondly, the left and right tracking wheels must be parallel to each other. And thirdly, the back tracking wheel must be perpendicular to the left and right tracking wheels. As long as you follow all three of these rules for placements, your odometry algorithm should work mathematically. So, as you can imagine, there are many ways to position these three tracking wheels. For example, this is a valid configuration, so is this, and this, and this. You get the idea. As long as you follow those three rules, you can place these tracking wheels anywhere. But to keep things simple for now, our tracking wheels will be positioned like this, where these two distances between the left and right tracking wheels to the tracking center are equivalent. And while we're doing this, let's set some constant variables for our robot. Let's say the distance from the left tracking wheel to the tracking center is TL, and let's just say this is 7.250 inches. And the distance from the right tracking wheel to the tracking center is TR, and this is also 7.250 inches. And finally, the back tracking wheel to the tracking center, we'll call this TB, and this will be 7.750 inches. These three distances will be the constants of our robot, and we'll be taking these into account during our calculations for the position and orientation vector. Okay, now that we've established our constants and where everything is located, back to tracking with arcs. We want to track the robot's motion in an arc. So as our first example, let's say the bot wants to move from where it is right now to here. If we draw a circle right here through these two tracking centers, we see that the robot's path actually follows an arc of 15 degrees. Sorry, this is very obviously not to scale. But let's just say this is 15 degrees. This is our main arc. The arc that our tracking center passes through, as you can see, and the arc that we'll be actually tracking. But there are two other arcs that are also formed by our tracking wheels. This outside arc, which our left tracking wheel passes through, we will call this the left arc. And it's, let's say, 17.606 inches. And this inner arc, which our right tracking wheel passes through, will be called the right arc. And it is 13.810 inches. And as we look closely at this diagram, we can see that this arc angle, this angle, is actually the same angle as the new orientation of the robot, the new orientation of the same robot over here. So if we can just calculate the angle for the tracking center's arc, we will actually figure out the orientation of the bot at its new position. So how do we calculate this angle? We start off by using the arc length formula S equals R times theta, where S is the arc length, R is radius, and theta is the angle of our arc in radians. In case you're not familiar with what radians are, it's just another unit of measure for angles, just like the degrees. To put this in perspective, it's like converting from inches to centimeters. To do that, you multiply inches by 2.54 to get the same length in centimeters. Well, to convert radians to degrees, you simply multiply the angle by a different constant. You multiply by 180 over pi. So let's say you want to convert 2 pi radians to degrees, you just multiply the 2 pi by 180 over pi to get 360 degrees, which is a full circle. So since the native output of the arc length formula is in radians, we will be using that to measure our angles instead of degrees. To calculate the angle of the arc traveled by the tracking center, we have to use the information from the tracking wheels, which makes up the left and right arcs. All three of these arcs, including the main arc, have the same arc angle because the arcs are concentric, meaning that they share the same center of the circle. They just have a different radius. So now let's do some math. Don't worry, it's very simple math. We know that the distance traveled by the left tracking wheel, which we will record down as delta L, is equal to the arc length of this arc, the left arc. And using the arc length formula from before, we know that the arc length is equal to the radius times angle. So delta L is equal to the radius of the left arc, which is consisted of the circle's radius, this length, circle's radius, which I will call big R, plus this length, TL, from before, right? The distance from the left tracking wheel to the tracking center. All this multiplied by theta, our arc angle, is equal to delta L. We can do the same for the right tracking wheel's arc length, which we will call delta R. The distance traveled by the right tracking wheel, which makes up this arc length for the right arc, which once again, according to the arc length formula, is equal to the radius of the right arc, consisted of the circle's radius, this radius, big R. But this time, instead of adding the tracking wheel constant, we subtract TR, this length, because we're tracking the inner arc, and multiplied by theta again, the arc angle. Now watch this. We divide the arc angle on both sides for both our equations. Then we can isolate the circle's radius for both of them. Now these two equations can be combined, which eliminates the circle's radius, which is our only unknown variable here. So we set them equal to each other, then multiply theta on both sides. Then get all our thetas on one side, factor it out, and finally isolate theta by dividing everything else over. And now we've arrived at our equation to calculate the instantaneous orientation of our robot using our tracking wheels. Let's test this out with our example here. Our theta is equals to 17.606, our left arc over here, minus 13.810, the right arc over here, over 7.25 plus 7.25, our two constants. This is equal to 0.2618 radians, which when converted to degrees is equal to 15 degrees over here.
So there you have it. If you just know how far each tracking wheel has moved, you can find the orientation of the robot anywhere on the field, since robot motion is just a lot of these arcs all combined. Instead of calculating relative orientation based on previous orientations, you can use these absolute quantities, delta L and delta R, to calculate it as an absolute quantity regardless of what movements the robot has done before. And because of this, we can adjust for past errors and correct our future movements. Alright, that's it for now. Today we covered how to find the orientation of the robot through odometry. Next time I see you, we'll be talking about how to calculate the position of the robot with odometry data. I really, really hope you liked this video and found it helpful. If you have any question at all, please leave a comment down below and I'll do my best to answer them. If you like this video, mine is all the messy handwriting, please give it a thumbs up and please consider subscribing if you like what you see and don't want to miss the next video on more odometry. Thank you so much for your support and I look forward to seeing you in the next video.